Dr Rajendra Pachauri, thank you for having breakfast with UNICEF. 5 years ago, you said that if climate change hadn't been reversed by now, it'd be too late. Is that still your belief?
Well, you know, what we found in the fourth assessment report was the fact that if you want to mitigate emissions of greenhouse gases, to stabilize temperature increase to around 2 degrees Celsius, then if we were to do that at least cost, then carbon dioxide emissions would have to peak no later than 2015. So what I said was, in the context of the least cost pathway by which the world would be able to stabilize temperature increase to about 2 to 2.4 degrees Celsius. Now, of course, it doesn't mean that you can't do it beyond 2015, but it's going to cost more. The impacts of climate change will be far more serious. And this is a choice that the governments of the world have to make.
Given the inaction, how bad are things now, and how bad do you see them getting in a very, very near future, 10 years, 20 years?
Well, you know, we've brought out a special report on extreme events and disasters, and let me just quote a couple of findings from that report. We find that heat waves are on the increase. We find extreme precipitation events are on the increase. We also find that with increase in average sea level, you find coastal flooding and some of these associated disasters becoming more frequent and more intense. Now, in the case of heat waves, we have said that if the world does nothing, then those heat waves, which take place currently, say, once in 20 years, will occur by the end of this century once in 2 years. Therefore, you know, the fact is that these will become far more expensive, and these will certainly become far more serious, most definitely for the poorest regions in the world.
Is there a risk then that climate change now will undo, or is already undoing, those advances made in development for the poorest people? Are we going to see increases in malnutrition, increases in disease, increases in water shortages?
Absolutely, because you know, you just don't have the capacity, you don't have the infrastructure and the capital in the poorest communities of the world for them to be able to put their lives together. So, you know, the little progress that they make can easily be wiped out by a single disaster.
Is there enough discussion, is there enough information about what the impact of climate change will be on children and what children need to protect and empower themselves?
I imagine this is something that perhaps people have to translate from the scientific findings that we bring out in the IPCC into what it really does to society. And undoubtedly, this will vary from place to place. There are some parts of the world where children are taken care of. They have the kinds of schools, the dwellings where perhaps they would be all right even if there was some kind of a disaster. There are other places where they're completely exposed to the elements. So I think we would really need to come up with very site-specific assessments of what this would do to children. But in general, one could say that children certainly will be very seriously impacted by what's going to happen with climate change.
You've often said that the science and the knowledge will still prevail, but there does seem a gap between the public's understanding and the scientific evidence. How dangerous is that gap, and how do we bridge it?
I think there'll always be inertia in the system, even in people's thinking, in their ability or willingness to accept new scientific findings. And frankly, if you go back in time, historically, this has happened with every piece of new scientific knowledge that has emerged. There have been some people who were conscientious, or I would say genuine skeptics of what was stated. There were others who had vested interests. And therefore, I think at this point of time, we can expect the same with climate change, because climate change is something which affects everything. If we are to take action, then it certainly affects every single activity. So I think what we really need to do is to sensitize the public on the win-win opportunities that we have. And to that extent, may I say, we in the scientific community are really not very well qualified to spread the message. This is something that others have to do. We are living in at least an information age where, I mean, as Gandhi rightly said, you have two options in a technological society. Either you deny what's going to happen through self-deception and, you know, rigidities that really don't get you anywhere, or you have checks, balances, you have a sort of a cultural basis by which you anticipate catastrophe if it's going to take place and start taking action early. So I hope we would be in the second category rather than the first.
This idea of intergenerational responsibility, is it missing from the discussion? Is it missing in the West and the East simply from the debate?
I think you're right. I think the debate has not really reached the point where people start worrying about the intergenerational impacts of what we're doing today. And I think the argument has to be framed in that light. And that's where I believe the scientific assessment of the IPCC perhaps needs to be carried further by others in looking at the social, psychological and other impacts that would take place.
It's been said that this generation has failed to sufficiently take the lead on climate change and a new generation needs to step up. Is that a fair request? Is it putting too much pressure on youth?
My expectation is that in the next few years, and I'm not talking of 10 years, you will see action taking place. I think we're at a stage where people are going to realize that this is something which is a win-win approach. And if we don't take action, then clearly it's not just their children and grandchildren that are going to be affected, it's going to affect us.
You've seen this debate go from denial to delays and maybe even today at best a real lack of progress, and yet you know what's at stake. Where's your optimism?
I think we really need to come to grips with understanding what climate change is going to do to different parts of the world. And the tipping points, therefore, will vary from location to location. And I think once we realize that and once we have an appreciation of the fact that every community on Earth is of some concern to us. I mean, when I had the privilege of receiving the Nobel Peace Prize on behalf of the IPCC in my speech, I talked about a Sanskrit term, which is Vasudev Kutumbukam, which means the universe is one family. And you know, if you have a problem in Somalia, in Sudan, I mean, the whole world is affected today. So why not with the impacts of climate change? And I think that's something people have to start understanding.
Dr. Pachauri, thank you very much.
Thank you.